Great. Thanks so much. And sorry I can't be down there in Mexico with you. But yeah, so I've been working with Dan and Mike and Andy on the Sustainability Commission to put together the Agenda 2030. And so I'm so glad they got to share that with you already. And what I want to talk about really is some of the work I've been doing, particularly on plastic pollution. And so I'm just going to share up my screen. That should be working.
It is. It's working.
So for me, really, my passion for the ocean began when I was actually hitchhiking around the world to a new job in Australia on board this amazing fuel power boat. We were on a campaign to promote renewable fuels all the way from England to the South Pacific. And it was on this journey that my eyes were really opened to so many of these issues that are going on around the world. And one was being woken in the middle of the night, hearing that scratching sound down the hull of a boat and coming up on deck to find that we were surrounded by plastic in really one of the most remote parts, over 1,000 miles from the nearest land. And then we started stopping at these small, and we were finding that the locals were struggling to catch fish because the commercial fishing vessels had emptied their waters of the fish that they knew how to catch. They were struggling to grow food in the ground because that sea level rise had caused their soil to become too salty. The knock-on effect of this that I was seeing was then this reliance on importing packaged food and drink that all, of course, came wrapped up in this new strange material. And so I ended up going back to live Tonga in the heart of the South Pacific to try and tackle this plastic issue. While this scene looks like absolute paradise, down on the ground it is a real story. And these communities are really struggling with no system, no place for any of their waste. So it gets dumped on the beach, in the ocean, and often burnt. And it was actually that burning of plastic, that toxic smell that kept getting up my nose that led me to learn more about these chemicals, these dioxins that are produced when you burn it. And just realizing that this is a really bad situation. These chemicals that lead to cancer, and they're things that we really don't want inside our bodies. And certainly these children living on these little islands didn't either. And so for me, this became my first mission, was to try and remove the plastic, the burning of plastic and the sit on these islands. So started working with the local community, but we quickly realized that here, as in many parts of the world, there isn't even the terminology for things like rubbish bin in the local language, because that concept of throwing something away doesn't even exist in the culture, because this plastic material is really so, so new to so many parts of the world. There literally is no system or even way of thinking about dealing with that waste. So we ended up doing an enormous cleanup project on these little Tongan islands, 6 tons of rubbish in just 5 hours with 3,000 local volunteers. That rubbish then got sorted and cleaned and packaged to be taken away, some to be recycled and other to go to a nearby landfill. And so that time in Tonga, I was dealing really firsthand with this waste issue on a small Pacific island, which we now know is just a sort of small version of what's happening in so many different countries. But I also then started, when I was walking along the beaches, noticing clearly washing up, having traveled a really long distance, often with writing on the packaging labels in languages that I didn't even recognize. And so it was this that got me asking more questions about where that plastic was coming from and why it was landing on these remote little beaches. And so I set off this time to California to start working with some of the oats to understand more about these great big areas of plastic that are actually accumulating in our oceans. And so that's what led to the next few years. But at this point, I still couldn't quite get my head around why there was all this plastic in the ocean in the first place. So I started to learn a little bit more about the material plastic itself, discovered that actually 50,000 plastic bags in our world every 3 seconds. And those bags, they get used once, maybe twice, probably three times at best, and then they get thrown away. And I was realizing that this material plastic, we use it to make things, design things that are designed to be used just once, like a bag or a bottle, and then thrown away out of a material that's designed to last forever and ever. And it's really science and product design that puts us in this situation of having so much waste with no. So then I thought we can maybe recycle that plastic. Can't we just turn it back into new things? Turns out that actually only between 5 and 10% of all the plastic we use actually gets recycled. And that number's so low because really plastic is a name that we give to hundreds of different materials that all have different properties and different chemical structures, and it's very hard to sort and separate that waste to be able to recycle it into a high quality product. So as it turns out, there's a huge amount of this plastic that really has no use, no value. And so it's not that surprising that much of it escapes landfill or doesn't have a landfill at all, and making its way down streams and drains and rivers. And ultimately, everything runs downhill to the ocean. This image here is in Los Angeles, a city which has a pretty great waste management system. And yet, this is still how much plastic is entering into the ocean. And then you've got somewhere like in coastal communities all over the world. So then the question is, where does it go and how does it move? So when it leaves land, it then meets those ocean currents. We have that great big clockwise rotation in each of our northern hemispheres and anti-clockwise in each of the southern hemispheres. And in the middle, the calm patch, the high, we in the science world call these gyres, these accumulation zones. And anything, whether it's seaweed or plastic, is going to want to move towards the middle of those accumulation zones. So they end up being at around 20 to 40 degrees, both north and south of the equator. And so we end up with 5 of these hotspots around the world. And so this here was actually the result of a computer model by a scientist in 2008. But at the time, only the North Pacific patch, as it's known, was the one that had actually been discovered. So for me, back in 2009, this became my next mission, was to go out to those other 4 gyres and find out if they even existed, if there was plastic there or not. So for this new project, Sea Dragon, which is one of the old Challenge 72 steel yachts that was built to race around the world in the wrong direction. And we managed to get enough funds together to buy this boat and have been really sailing it all over the world ever since, doing this scientific research, mostly looking at plastics. And along the way, taking with us of people, 10 new guest crew join a voyage on every leg, a mix of scientists, filmmakers, journalists, educators, to go out and see this problem. And when we first got out there and started fishing up these bits of plastic, in the middle of these gyres, really this is all we managed to find in one of the densest spots in our ocean. And so it wasn't quite stacking up, given that we knew 8 million tons of plastic was going in every year. And so we quickly realized what was happening, and that actually these big bits of plastic break down into tiny fragments, what we call microplastics, smaller than your little fingernail. And you can't see the microplastics when you look at the water, but when you then deploy the manta trawl net over the side of the boat and drag that net along the surface of the ocean with a very fine mesh, we then pull it back on board, turn the socket to a sieve, and that's where we then find these hundreds of tiny fragments of plastic. And what we realise now is that most of the plastic in our ocean is actually this big. It's so small that you can't see it from satellite image from space. You can't see it when you're sailing along, but it's actually like a fine soup that's now covering the whole surface of the planet. So we spend these next couple of years crisscrossing our way all over the globe, going to each of these gyres. And sadly, everywhere we went, we found the same thing. And not only in the middle of these gyres, but everywhere in between just has less, really. But the plastic's still there. When we get those samples on, we have to analyze them. We have to work out what's plastic and what's plankton. And it turns out in this image that those two pieces there are actually plastic. And so we realize how hard it is for the fish to distinguish the difference between their food, the plankton, and this plastic. So when we start catching fish, we then found things like this rainbow runner that actually had 17 fragments of plastic inside its stomach. And so this, for us on the science team, really kind of shifted the focus of the work, and the fact that we know that plastic and other chemicals are getting into the food chain we are at the top of. It moved the focus of the research not only onto the physical presence of this plastic in our oceans, but what it might mean for us and other species that live on our planet, and chemically as well, and whether there's a chance that that's actually reaching us at the top of the food chain. And when we did some blood studies to actually look at what we have got inside us, this was a couple of years ago, I discovered that actually I have 29 of these 35 chemicals that we tested for inside my body. And it turns out that we all have this body burden, these synthetic chemicals within us that really shouldn't be there. And so we continue these voyages really looking for more answers. But this quite significant moment, that moment when you finally reach land after a month at sea doing this work, this moment has become more and more significant for me, because the more time I spend out at sea, the more I realise that the solutions to this plastic, toxic and other pollution issue, they all start right here on land. And so much of the work now is moving to what it is that we can do about it. And obviously, because the problem starts with us, so does the solution. And so we're looking at ways that we can get from down the bottom there at the ocean, where we're seeing this plastic, all the way up to the source of this problem, as close to the source as we can get. So, you know, at that level, we need to think about how we can minimize the damage that plastic out there is already causing. But better still, we need to look how we use these ocean plastic materials again before the end of its waste, whether that's turning it into energy or turning it into something like a shoe, as Adidas are doing. Better still than that, we can look at how we can close the loop so we don't have waste at all, and looking at all sorts of ways that we can actually design a circular economy, or even just avoiding using that plastic in the first place and going for legislative bans and alternatives to the material. as I mentioned, so much of this work, it happens on land, and many of our projects now are really focusing on what is that impact that is particularly these sailors who go out and see the issue firsthand, and what can they bring back and what change can they instigate? That we've been doing with our own sailing community for a few years, and more recently started with Volvo Ocean Race about this idea of how sailors and athletes can become a voice for the ocean as well. And as part of 11th Hour project, we've actually been delivering sustainability training to the athletes on the Volvo Ocean Race team and previously the America's Cup team, the Ben Ainslie America's Cup team. So looking at ways that the sailing community can be part of it in that way as well. And also resources, toolkits, so that there's basically better access for people who want to become spokespeople and advocates on the issue. But really, there is so much more that we can do as well. As you heard from the... I'm just going to stop sharing my screen there now. As you heard earlier with the work on the Agenda 2030, it's everything from boat design to events to working directly with members and sailors. There's really at every point of the spectrum from source to ocean, as a sailing community, we can be working together to be part of the plastic problem solution and also many other ocean challenges out there as well. So I hope that you get a chance to really have a look at that document that's been put together, have a read through, and I really look forward to working with World Sailing on implementing it in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. Thank you very much. Thanks. And thanks for staying up late at night here for us. So we're glad we got to hear from you. It was a wonderful presentation.
I hope you have a great afternoon.